there. My name is Nana Kagga. I'm your Woman Crush Wednesday, and I am seated here on this show, living, doing what we do best, talking about everything and anything, discussing issues from socioeconomic to political, and enjoying every minute of it on Urban TV. Stay tuned. Do not go away. We're going to talk about everything. Nana Kagga is a mother, a daughter, a sister, a filmmaker, scriptwriter, director, producer, petroleum engineer, a women activist, a motivational speaker, voice for the voiceless. What can I say? I do everything I can, and it's quite chaotic. Nana, zina batiriga. Ndi mumbeja omanyo Uganda buladde kuba abana egwe mwe bani mwandi nsanze wa. Actually, yes, I'm a princess. Being of royal blood is just simply, I think it's a blessing. I think in Uganda culture, they tend to treat you with such reverence and respect that your sense of self-esteem is just really more phenomenal than most. So sometimes when you, like, you go to the village and you say something at such a young age, and even grown men are like, yes, sebo, nedda sebo, sebo bobo simye. It's actually a very, very powerful thing. So being of royal blood, I consider it an honor, and it's humbling because you have to give back to people. And it's there's also a lot of expectations, like people say abambeja bayina okuba balungi abempisa. So it really is like a very, very strange thing to be, and yet still try to be a career woman. I grew up in Masaja, which by then was a village. Now it's like a town. It's a town off Busabala in Wakiso district. So I had six brothers and sisters, and we lived in the village, and right outside our house was this hill. So every time it rained, you just get in basins, and then one of your siblings would push you from up the hill. Do you understand what that is? So you come careening down in this basin, and you either land properly or you fall out of the basin and land with your head. I'm telling you, I don't know if this generation understands what growing up back in the day. My other fond memory was cooking in those little cans of Blue Band. That was like, it was crazy because you'd go to the kitchen, your mother would give you like one piece of matoke and a palm full of beans. Then that was like the ultimate goal, is to cook that food. And any one of your siblings that misbehaved would not partake. It was just so, I don't know, I think that our generation was a lot simpler being a child. My perception of life is very simple. We are all visitors here, and we need to learn what we must learn and then return home. I think that's a very strange thing, but I think our lives here, they're meant to teach us lessons. They are meant to enrich what we come into the world with. So I'm a very, very big believer that we're just here to visit, to learn and unlearn. And then there's a place that we call home. Some people call it heaven, others call it hell, others call it another realm. But I think that we all return to where we came from. So my perception about life is, live it. You know, we spend so much time worried about things that are going to happen in the future that we forget to be present and enjoy the moment, the now. Because even as I speak to you, it's not a guarantee that I'll be here 5 minutes later, that I'll be here 10 minutes later. So live your life, love a lot. People think that when you say I love someone, that you're supposed to hold on to them forever. I think that we need to learn that we need to let people go, because everyone that's in your life right now on this journey is there for a reason, but not everyone is meant to stay till the end. So I tend to love a lot, and if people need to leave, I let them go. I laugh a lot. I cherish my family, I cherish my friends, I adore my children, I love my parents. They're fierce people, they're warriors. So my philosophy on life is very simple. Live, laugh, love, and then we all have to go home sometime. This is my opinion. That is the disclaimer. My explanation, that there's so many young women out there that haven't, that are not married or are not in serious relationships, is very simple. I think we have a generation of women that are now not bothered by consequences. They live by the credo, you only live once. So they talk about their bodies and how they own their destiny. And yet in reality, a woman is, your choices will affect the way people see you. That is the reality of our lives. So if you date one guy, then you date another in the same circle, then you date another, and then you do things. These days of social media, by the way, we used to get up to things that nobody would like post them, or nobody would like put them on front street, as they call it. But in this day and age of social media, private lives have become public. Everyone puts their stuff out there. They talk about, you cannot be in a relationship in a year with six different bays and every single one features on your page, and then you expect someone to say, you know what, that is the person I want to spend the rest of my life with, when in 6 years you've changed clothes, as I like to call them, six times. Or rather, everyone is the love of your life. Also, people aren't willing to love anymore without attachment of material things. I went to Kampala kindergarten. Actually, it still exists. I went to Kampala kindergarten, then I went to Kitante primary school, then I went to Kampala parents, and then Kampala parents to Gayaza high school. Can you imagine me, a Gayaza girl? Okay, that didn't last long. 2 years in, I had to kindly leave Gayaza. Apparently, my personality and character were detrimental to the grooming of society's young women. So I ended up at the Red Maid School. No, I did a term at Makere College, and then I had to go to the Red Maid School in Bristol, Red Maid School, and then University of Birmingham. And then, yeah, that's it. Then I graduated, I graduated as a chemical engineer from the University of Birmingham. And then I went on to do weapons research for the US government in US. Oh my God, it's so boring talking about like my life. It's just like, why don't we discuss someone else's life? Is that possible? Is that okay? Do I get a vote? Is this a democracy? Okay, all right, okay. So after university, I went on to work in Albuquerque, New Mexico on US military contract. Then after that, I went to Hollywood, and the rest is history. Let me fall, wish that you would take it all away. First of all, I worked for Tullow Oil as a subsurface engineer for 8 years. Uganda's oil, right through from exploration to appraisal to the early stages of development, which is where they are now. Exploration in petroleum engineering is so exciting. It's a journey of discovery. I mean, it's like every well you hit, that's a discovery. It's so exciting to be in that moment in time. And then also the appraisal, when you actually determine how many reserves are recoverable, that's also really exciting. The development phase got a little tricky for me, whereby I felt like we were just there was no real direction or vision of where this whole industry was going, so I decided to take a break. And I took a break at a time in Uganda where I feel like film and visual media are key, because we're living in a time of change. We're living in a time of the generation that actually exists, as we like to call them, the millennials, are actually making changes. We have people coming up and changing the scene, whether it be political, whether it be social, whether it be economic. You have got the Natalie Bitatures, who are like Forbes 30 under 30. This young woman is Ugandan and she's so phenomenal. So why not tell these stories? We've got Bobby Chagulanyi Sentamu. I mean, he's come from being a musician to now being a very prominent figure. When one discusses Uganda, one must mention this young man. So film to me is where we must go if we must have these discussions, if we must see these changes, because libraries are almost extinct. People don't want to read anymore. They want to watch a story on the screen. So if I have the ability to give them that, and I can come at it from a truthful point of view, I think that is where I must be. I must tell the stories of the voiceless. And that is how I feel right now, because I feel like we have such a rich culture, whether it be historical or present, and yet our stories are being told from Hollywood, they're being told from Nigeria, they're being told from South Africa, and yet the Ugandan voice somehow manages to disappear all the time. So my quest is to actually be that Ugandan voice, hopefully, and do it really well so that maybe I can go down in history as having told the stories nobody wanted to touch.